Question number 61 from the NIELIT technical part, and this paper is from 17 December 2017. And first question is from the technical part: the collection of Turing recognizable languages are closed under which of the operations? Okay, so first let's look at the closure properties of different languages, then we can answer this question: what is Turing recognizable? Okay, so we have languages like this. And we have some properties, some operations. For example, we have operations like this. For example, we have languages, regular language. Then we have DCFL language. Then we have CFL languages. CSL languages, that is context sensitive language. Then we have recursive languages. And then we have recursively enumerable languages. Okay, these are the languages we have, and this this recursive language is also known as Turing decidable language. Turing decidable language, and this recursively enumerable language is also known as Turing recognizable language. Turing recognizable, or you can, we have different names like semi decidable. So all these names are given to recursively enumerable languages like semi-decidable, partially decidable, Turing recognizable, all these things. Okay, and then we have operations. Let's see which language is enclosed under which operation. So we have union operation, we have intersection operation, complementation, and then concatenation, linear closure, and reversal. So regular languages are closed under all operations. Okay, so regular languages are closed under all operations. Then we have DCFL. DCFLs are not closed under union and are not closed under intersection, but they are closed under complementation. Okay, only DCFL. And then they are not closed under concatenation, not closed under linear closure, not closed under reversal. Okay. CFLs are closed under union, they are closed under intersection, okay, they are closed under union operation, but they are not closed under intersection operation, okay, they are not closed under complementation operation. This is the difference between DCFL and CFL. CFLs are closed under union operation, but DCFL are not closed. They are not closed under intersection operation. Okay, DSFL is closed under complementation operation, but CFL is not closed under complementation operation. Okay, then we have concatenation operation. Okay, so CFL is closed under concatenation operation. Then linear closure, yes, CFL are closed under linear closure. Then reversal, yes, CFLs are closed under reversal. Then we have CSL languages. CSL languages are closed under union operation, intersection operation, and complementation operation. They are not closed, or you can say this is the open problem. Neither you can say that they are closed, and neither nor you can say that they are not closed. This is open problem. Okay, then we have concatenation. So CSLs are closed under concatenation operation, and then they are closed under linear star. Okay, then recursively enumerable recursive languages. Recursive languages are closed under all operations. Okay, they are closed under all operations. Recursively enumerable languages are closed under union, they are closed under intersection, but they are not closed under complementation. Okay, this is important because the question is asking about Turing recognizable languages, and we are talking about Turing recognizable languages. They are also known as recursively enumerable languages. Recursively enumerable languages. So recursively enumerable languages are closed under union, closed under intersection, but not closed under complement operation. They are closed under concatenation, they are closed under linear closure. Okay, we do not have any information available for reversal. So Turing recognizable languages are closed under union, they are closed under intersection, but they are not closed under complementation. They are closed under concatenation, they are closed under star closure. Okay, this is star closure, so they are closed. So in this case, 1, 2, 4, 5 are the correct options. That is 1, 2, 4, 5. C is the right answer for this question. Question number 62 says, a regular expression is A plus B star C is equivalent to what? Okay, so this regular expression, we can have the, for example, strings can be like this. A, we can take A or from B star C. Okay, so for length one, we can take A. We can take null from B star and then the string will be C. Null into C, that is C. Then we can have two string of length two, that is BB. Okay, BC, like this. Then we can take 2 power of B, that is BB. C, or you can have B, 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 C, like this. So as you can see, B can be 0 or B can be 1. Set of A is saying set of all set of strings with either 1 or 1 or more occurrence of B's. This is the problem, 1 or more. Okay, this is not a plus. Okay, this is star. Star means it will include null. Null means B can also be 0. If you are saying B star simply means null, B, BV, like this. So they can be 0, B's can be 0 or more. Okay, so this is false. B star C plus A, this is okay. They are these two regular expressions are equivalent, B star C plus A or A plus B star C. Okay, so this is okay. C is saying set of strings with either A or either A, okay, simple A, or 0 or more, 0 or more occurrences of B followed by C. This is right. Okay, we can have 0 or more occurrence of B due to this star operation followed by C and set of strings with either A. You can take either A or from this or from this. So C is also correct. So D is the right option, that is both B and C are correct. Question number 63 says, consider a relation RABCD with the following functional dependencies. F equals to, we have functional dependencies like this. A tends to BC and then C tends to D. We have these functional dependencies and we have to find out the normal form for this relation. Okay, if you can see, the key for this relation is, if I take A, A will cover ABC but it will not cover D, so I have to take AC. So if I take key, that is AC, AC is the key, this will give me A, B, C, D. Can we have any another key in this? Okay, so this is the only key in this relation. AC is the key of this relation. So first functional dependency is partial functional dependency. Okay, how? This is giving A tends to B, A tends to C, then C tends to D. Okay, as you can see, this is a partial dependency. If I check from, if I start from the BCNF, obviously it is not a BCNF language. It is not a BCNF because BCNF says left hand side of the functional dependency should be a super key. But A is not a super key. A is actually a prime attribute, that is proper subset of a super key. Okay, or a candidate key. So A is a prime attribute, not a super key, because AC is the super key by combined. So this is not a super key. C is not a super key. So this will fail BCNF. So this is not in BCNF. Then we will check for 3NF. Is it in 3NF? 3NF says either left hand side should be a super key or right hand side should be a prime attribute. So if you look at the definition of 3NF, 3NF says if we have a functional dependency like this, alpha tends to beta. So this definition of 3NF says either alpha should be a super key or right hand side, that is beta, should be a prime attribute. So as you can see, this first functional dependency is not satisfying any of the conditions of 3NF, because neither left hand side is a super key nor right hand side is a prime attribute. So this will fail 3NF. So if you look at this, A tends to C. Okay, now because this is failing BCNF and 3NF, now we have to check for 2NF. 2NF says there should not be any partial dependency. Okay, no partial dependency should be there. But as you can see, partial dependency means prime attribute implies non-key. This is known as partial dependency. Prime attribute means a proper subset of a candidate key. Candidate key is AC. So if in left hand side we have anything, any subset of these, and in right hand side we have non-key attribute. Non-key attributes means all the attributes which are not in key. For example, we have four attributes in relation A, B, C, D. A, C are key attributes and B, D are non-key attributes. Okay, B, D are non-key attributes in this relation. So if in left hand side we have proper subset of this, and in right hand side we have any of these, then that will be a partial dependency. As you can see, first one is itself a partial dependency. See, this one is not a partial dependency. Why this is not a partial dependency? Because in left hand side and right hand side, both are the prime attributes. Okay. So partial dependency says in left hand side should be a prime attribute and right hand side should be a non key. C is not a non key. So this is not a partial dependency, because this first functional dependency is failing for 2NF. This means the relation is only in 1NF, neither in BCNF nor in 3NF and not in 2NF. So the relation is in 1NF only. Question number 64 says, which of the following statements is or are true in the context of interpreters? Okay, interpreters. First one says, interpreters process program according to the logical flow of control through the program. So what is interpreter? So if you look at the compilers and interpreters, we have two things, that is interpreter and then we have compiler. So what is the difference between compiler and interpreter? So interpreter, what interpreter does is, interpreter take as an input the source program and then line by line it converts one line and executes. Okay, what interpreter does, it converts one line at a time from source language to target language and then execute that line. But what compiler does, compiler takes the complete source program and then complete source program is converted to target program, which means in one complete scan, compiler will scan the complete program and it will convert the complete program to the one program in one shot to the target language. Okay, but interpreter will convert the source program to target program line by line. So if you look at the architecture of this, for example, interpreter will be like this. So interpreter will take as an input the program. Okay, program will be given as an input to interpreter. And then interpreter will produce the output. Okay, because every time you want to execute a program, and if you are using only interpreter, you do not have any compiler in your computer, and you are trying to execute your program through interpreter, so you do not need to compile your program. What you can give your program to interpreter, and interpreter will convert at the time of execution, interpreter will convert each line into the target machine and will execute. So it will keep converting and executing. Each line will be compiled and then executed, or you can say interpreter is like a compiler which will actually compile a single line and execute it, compile line, next line and execute, compile line and execute. So it will go with the flow of program, with the flow of program. Wherever program jumps, interpreter will also jump. So like this, if you have seen the IDEs like integrated development environment, like we have NetBeans or Visual Studio, in these IDEs we can put a checkpoint, okay, or you can say breakpoints. For if you have any doubt that you have some error in a program but you are not able to find that error, what you can do is you can execute your program with the interpreter. So interpreter will tell you and in which line there is an error and where you can find the error. So interpreter will take program and execute it. So when you are using interpreter in place of compiler, you need to keep interpreter in the main memory all the time, because every time you want to execute a program you have to interpret it. Okay, so what compiler does is, compiler takes your source program. For example, this is your source program, this is given to compiler, then compiler converts this into target program. Okay, compiler compiles using some faces of compiler and converts it into target program. Then target program is given to, okay, target program is given to abstract machine, or you can say virtual machine, and then virtual machine gives output. So nowadays what happens is interpreters and compilers are used combinedly. Okay, compiler converts the program from source language to target language and interpreter executes the program. Okay, interpreter executes the program and compiler compiles the program. So if you look at the execution process in compilation and interpreter, so at the time of running, when you try to run your program, interpreter will take much time. Why? because at the time of when you are running the program, when the program is in execution, interpreter will also be compiling the program. It will be finding the errors. Okay. So before going to the next line, interpreter will first report the error of current line. So first you have to fix the current line which you are executing. If there is an error in the current line, the interpreter will not move to next line. Okay, so like this interpreter works. But in case of compilation, you have completely compiled your code in prior and now you can simply execute the program. You do not need to recompile it. But in interpreter, every time you have to compile your program line by line and execute line by line. So if we look at the options, interpreters process program according to the control flow of control through the program. This is true. Interpreter will go line by line and wherever your program jumps, interpreter will also jump. S2 says interpreter translates and executes the error free first instruction before it goes to the second. So we have talked about it. If you have error in current line, it will first report the error. And when you fix the error, then it will move to next line. C says interpreter processing time is less compared with the compiler. This is false. Because interpreter will take more time to execute the program in comparison to compiler. Because compiler compiles the program priorly and then they can simply execute whenever you want. Okay, so a program will be compiled only once and you can execute it many times. Lisp and Prolog are interpreted languages. This is true. Lisp and Prolog are interpreted languages. Initially when they came in 1960s, they were interpreted languages. But later on, then when compiler was designed, they become compiler interpreter both. So now Lisp and Prolog are both interpreted and compiled languages. Okay. So Lisp and Prolog were initially interpreted languages. So only S3 is false. S1, S2, S4 are true. So according to this, option D is right answer for this question. Question number 65. According to the given language, which among the following expression does it correspond to? So language is given like this. We have a language in which strings can be formed from 0 to 1. Okay. Language is like this. X is a string which can be formed from the two alphabets 0 and 1. Okay. And what is the condition for this string? X is of length 4 or less. Okay, 4 or less. 4 or less. The length of this string should be less than 4. Okay, the string of the length is 4 less than or equals to 4. So, what is the less than equals to 4? The length of the string can be 0, 1, 2, 3 or 4. So, this is simply saying the length of the string is at most 4. Okay, at most 4. Length of 4 or less. So first one is saying you can have the language of the regular expression for this language is like this 0 plus 1 plus 0 plus 1 like this. This is false. Why this is false? Because this is not generating null. Null can also be the part of this language. Why? Because x is the length of 4 or less. 0 is also less than 4. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 can be the length of the strings. 0 plus 1 to the power 4. The same problem with this language also. Okay, this will not generate null. 0, 1 to the power 4, this will only generate the minimum length of 0, 1. Okay, minimum length will be 0, 1. So this is obviously false. This option is right because this is generating null and all the strings with the 0 and 1. Okay, so this is the right answer for this question. Question number 67. This question says, if any string of a language L can be effectively enumerated, okay, enumerated by an enumerator in lexicographic order. Okay, lexicographic order, then the language is what? So this question was also asked in GATE 2003. This question is from GATE 2003 also. And this question is saying if any string of a language L can be effectively enumerated by an enumerator in a lexicographic order, then the language is what? This is the definition of recursive languages and recursive enumerable languages. Okay, this is the definition of recursively enumerable languages. So the option for this, the answer for this question is recursively enumerable, but not necessarily recursive. Recursive, but not recursively, recursively context-free. Context-free, but not necessarily regular or regular. So D is the right answer for this question. That is recursively enumerable, but not necessarily recursive. Question number 68. Which of the following is not a deliverable of the structured system analysis? So in structured system analysis, okay, in the requirement analysis phase, what we do is we do the requirement engineering. Okay, so in requirement engineering we have phases like this: requirement elicitation. So first phase in the requirement analysis is requirement elicitation, in which we gather the requirements from the user using the using many methods, for example like interviews, brainstorming or GDs. So all these methods are applied with the customers to find the requirements. Okay, requirement elicitation. In second phase what we do is we analyze the requirement. Okay, analyze the requirements. Then what we do is we document the requirements. Okay, document, in which we prepare the SRS document in this phase. Finally we verify the requirements. Okay, validation. Validation means check whether all the requirements are covered or not, whether we have redundant requirements in the SRS document. So all these things are done in the requirement engineering. So in the analysis the requirement phase, when we are analyzing the requirements, what we do it with the requirement modeling. Okay, requirement modeling. For example, in requirement modeling what we do is we try to map the requirements to some diagrams. For example, user client is explaining his requirements to you and you are trying to note down them. So what you do is you try to note down them using some methodologies. For example, for requirement modeling we use DFDs. Okay, we use use case diagrams. Okay, we use UML diagrams, we use ER diagrams. Okay, so for DFDs, to store the information of DFDs, for example, to store the information of database, we use the indexing. Okay, in indexing what we do is we store the information of some of the blocks in the indexes to make the access faster. For example, for that purpose, for DFD we use data dictionaries. Okay, so all these are used in the requirement modeling phase of the system analysis or requirement analysis phase. Okay, so these are the deliverables in this requirement engineering phase. For example, SRS is a deliverable of system analysis phase, DFD is a deliverable, ER diagram is a deliverable, data dictionary is a deliverable, UML is a deliverable in system analysis phase. But prototyping model is not deliverable in this phase. Prototyping model means you are presenting a rough model of your software to the client for the feedback and for some corrections. Okay, so but this is not the part of this analysis phase. Question number 69. This question is being asked many times in this question is being already asked in GATE 2011. Okay, UGC NET 2013 June. Okay, so this question is being repeated many times in many exams. This question is saying the time taken to switch between user and kernel modes of execution be T1. So T1 is the time taken to switch from user mode to kernel mode, while the time taken to switch between two processes be T2. Which of the following is true? What is the relation between T1 and T2? So T1 is the switch time from process to user mode to kernel mode. So user mode is a limited mode, but kernel mode is a super mode. Super mode means you can access any memory location, you can execute any instruction, okay, in the computer, you can access any hardware. So you have unrestricted access to the resources in the kernel mode. But user mode is limited. Okay, whenever in user mode, if you want to make, you want to use any resource, for example, you want to access memory, you have to request the operating system through the system calls that I want to access the memory, I want to open a file, I want to close a file. So if you want to access any device in the user mode, you have to make a request to the operating system through the system calls. But in kernel modes, you do not need to make any system call. You have unrestricted access to kernel modes. Okay. So this is definitely, this kernel mode is used by the operating system. So user cannot be given the kernel mode access or privileged access. So in kernel mode, we execute the privileged instructions, which can access any hardware without the permission of operating system, because kernel mode is the part of operating system. Kernel itself is the part of the operating system. So to switch from user mode to kernel mode, you need to modify only a single bit. Okay, there is a bit in a register and you have to make this bit from 0 to 1. If you want to switch from user mode to kernel mode, this is a simple task. You have to modify a simple bit. But in switching from one process to another process, what you need to do is, for example, you have two running processes. P1 is running and then P2 comes. So what you need to do is, first you need to save the PCP of this process, because you will come back. Saving the PCB means, process control block, in which you store all the informations related to process P1. For example, list of open files, what is the program counter value, because when you come back to process P1, you want to execute your instructions from where you left. That's why you are storing the value of program counter. All the resources you are using, all these things will be stored. Then what we need to do is, we need to restore the PCB of P2. Okay, so we have to do many things in the process switching. Save the PCB of current process, then restore the PCB of the process which you want to run. You need to send the complete process P1 to disk, back to the disk, and you have to load the process P2 to memory. So you, lot of things are done in the process when you are switching between two processes. Definitely time taken in T2 is greater than time taken in T1. T1 is switching from user mode to kernel mode, in which you need to modify a single bit in a register on the hardware level. So this will be very fast process. So T1 is less than T2, is the right answer for this question. Question number 70. Which of the following statements are not true? Okay, are not correct. Statement 1 says 3NF decomposition is always lossless join and dependency preserving. This is true. Okay, because every 3NF decomposition is always dependency preserving and lossless also. Statement 2 says 3NF decomposition is always lossless join but may or may not be dependency preserving. This is false. Okay, if S1 is true, then S2 is definitely a false, because they are contradictory statements. S3 says BCNF decomposition is always lossless join and dependency preserving. This is false. Okay, in BCNF, lossless join is always possible, but dependency preserving is not always possible. S4 is saying BCNF decomposition is always lossless join, but may or may not be dependency preserving. This is true. Okay, we can look at the example. How is this true? Let's say I have a relation RABCD and have set of functional dependencies, that is AB tends to C, and then let's say I have B tends to D, and then we have C tends to A. So these are the three functional dependencies. Let's check for BCNF. The key of this relation will be AB. Okay, AB will be the key, because AB plus will give all the values. AB itself, then AB tends to C, C will be given by AB, then we can have B tends to D, that is ABCD. So A is in the right hand side of C, so that's why BC is always also a key. So BC will give me B, C, and C will give A, and B will give D. So all the attributes are given by BC, so BC also a key. So let's look at the BCNF definition. BCNF definition says, if we have any functional dependency like this, it alpha tends to beta, then the all left hand side should have super keys. In all the functional dependencies, left hand side should be a super key. This will satisfy BCNF, no problem. But this and this are not satisfying the BCNF definition. Okay, so you have to decompose the relation into two parts, that is, first, this relation RABCD is decomposed, because in decomposition what we do is, whatever functional dependencies are violating the BCNF definition, keep them in the separate relation. For example, this is satisfying. So we will have one relation R1 in which we will have these three attributes. Then we will have a separate relation BD which is not satisfying the BCNF property. How we do the decomposition into two relations? R1 is ABC and R2 decomposition will be the this relation, okay, this complete relation minus right hand side of this. Okay, so this will be BD. So as you can see, if you take for lossless join, the condition is that if you take the intersection of these two relations, R1 intersection R2, whatever attributes comes, as you can see, B is the common attribute. So R1 intersection R2 is B. So common attribute should be the key of one of these relations. So this relation R2 is giving the functional dependency, that is B tends to D. This is giving the functional dependency AB tends to C and C tends to A. These two functional dependencies are given by this relation. Okay, C tends to A and B tends to C. B tends to D is given by this. So B is the key in this relation and B is the common attribute. So B is the key of this relation, and whatever common attribute is there from R1, R2, this should be key of one of these relations. Okay, this is okay because B is the key of R2. That's why this is lossless join. Okay, but if you look at this, this is not BCNF. This relation is not in BCNF. This is okay, this is in BCNF, but this is not a BCNF relation because the key of this relation is AB. Okay, AB plus is ABC. But this relation is actually violating the BCNF decomposition. So you have to further decompose R1. Okay, we have R1, that is ABC. In this relation, this functional dependency is violating the BCNF decomposition. So we have to take ABC. Okay, this is ABC. So how we decompose the relations? Subtract from this complete relation, subtract the right hand side of the functional dependency which is violating the BCNF decomposition. So from ABC I have to subtract A, so the new relation will be BC. This will become BC because I have to subtract the right hand side of the relation of the functional dependency which is violating the BCNF decomposition. In this we will have CA. Okay, for this functional dependency does not exist, we do not have any functional dependency for this. For this we will have functional dependency C tends to A. Okay, so if you take the, let's say this is R12 and this is R13. So if you take the common of R12 and R13, it will be the attribute C. C is the common attribute in these two relations and C is the key of this relation. So this is lossless join. This is lossless join. But this complete decomposition is not dependency preserving. Why this is not dependency preserving? Because B tends to D is preserved from this. Okay, from R2. Now R1 is preserving AB tends to C, but when we decompose R1 further into BC and CA, C tends to A, B tends to D is preserved, and C tends to A is preserved from here, but AB tends to C is not preserved. That's why all BCNF decompositions are not dependency preserving. Okay, not a dependency preserving. This is BCNF decomposition and this is not dependency preserving. But all the 3NF decompositions will be dependency preserving. If we look at the 3NF decomposition, 3NF decomposition will be like this. Okay, this 3NF decomposition will be like this. We will apply the 3NF definition. If we apply this 3NF definition on this, 3NF definition says either left hand side should be a super key or right hand side should be a prime attribute. Okay, this is fine because left hand side is a super key. Look at this, B tends to D. Neither the left hand side is a super key nor right hand side is a prime attribute. According to 3NF definition, this is okay because in this right hand side is a prime attribute. So only this is the only functional dependency which is violating 3NF. Okay, this is violating 3NF. So what you need to do is you need to keep all the attributes in separate table. For example, R1 is a table ABCD. Now you have decomposed to two relations. In R1 relation, we will have all the attributes which are satisfying 3NF property. This is satisfying 3NF property. So ABC will be in one table and B tends to D, that is BD, will be in a different table. So this is 3NF decomposition. So in this relations are AB tends to C. Functional dependencies will be AB tends to C, which are implied on this relation, and C tends to A. These two functional dependencies will be implied on this relation R1. In this we will have B tends to D. Okay, so this AB tends to C is in 3NF, this is okay. C tends to A is in 3NF, this is okay. The key for this relation is B. Okay, B tends to D is okay because B is a key and B tends to D is a 3NF. Okay, this is in 3NF. This is satisfying a 3NF deconvolution. So this this decomposition is in 3NF. And if we take the common of these R1 and R2, the common will be B, and which is the key of this relation, R2 relation. So this is lossless join and dependency preserving also, because AB tends to C is also preserved, C tends to A is preserved, B tends to D is also preserved. So all the functional dependencies are preserved in 3NF. So any 3NF decomposition will always be lossless join and dependency preserving, but BCNF may be or may not be dependency preserving, but it will always be lossless join. So S1 and S4 are true. It is asking what? Not correct. Not correct means S2 and S3 are not correct. So D is the right answer for this question. Question number 71. This question is saying, consider a non-pipelining machine with stages, with 6 stages. We have 6 stages. These are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, we have 5 stages in this. The length of each stage is R 20 nanosecond, 10 nanosecond, 30, 25, 40 and 50 nanosecond respectively. Suppose for implementing a pipelining, the machine adds 5 nanosecond of overhead to each stage of the clock skew and setup. What is the speed of factor of the pipelining system, ignoring any hazard impact? So we have to find out the speed up. And we know that the formula for speed up is equals to execution time taken in non-pipeline divided by execution time taken in pipeline. Okay, always remember, whenever the number of instructions are not specified, so for non-pipelining, and we know that for non-pipelining the formula for execution time is, in case of non-pipelining, is number of instructions into time taken for each instruction. In case of pipelining, the execution time is executed like this, k plus n minus 1 into tp. But this formula is only applied whenever the number of instructions are given. But in this case, number of instructions are not given, which means we can assume that the number of instructions are very large. Okay, we have very large instructions. In this case, k will be much smaller than n. Okay, because k is the number of stages that are 5. So we have large number of instructions. In this case, n will be greater than k. So this term k minus 1 will be neglected. So execution time in case of pipeline will also become n into tp. So now speed up becomes, execution time taken in non-pipeline is n into tn, and execution time taken in pipeline is n into tp. So this will simply become tn by tp. Now we have to find out the time taken in non-pipeline and time taken in pipeline. We know that in time taken in pipeline, when we have this is not a uniform pipelining. This is, we have different stage delays, which means the time taken will be maximum of stage delays. For example, maximum of 20, 10, 30, 25, and 40. 20, 10, 30, 25, 40, and 15. So we have 6 stages and 15 nanoseconds. Maximum of these plus, we have to add the skew time. Okay, skew, it can be skew time, it can be a register delay or anything. So the maximum of all these is 40, and we know that skew time is given 5 nanoseconds. So time taken in case of pipeline will be 45 nanoseconds. And we know that in case of non-pipelining, it will be addition of all the stages. Okay, add all the stages, because in non-pipelining we have to execute in serial manner. First we will execute complete one instruction, then we will schedule second instruction after the completion of first instruction. So TP will be 20. Time taken in non-pipelining will be addition of all the stages plus 40 plus 15, and this will be 140 nanoseconds. So speed up will be 140 nanosecond divided by 45 nanoseconds, that is 3.11. okay, so speed up is 3.11, that is C. Question number 72. The number of integers between 1 and 500, both inclusive. Okay, both inclusive, that are divisible by 3 or 5 or 7. This is important. 3 or 5 or 7. So what we need to do is, first we need to find out how many numbers are divided by 3, how many numbers are divided by 5, by 7 and 3 or 5, 3 and 5, 5 and 7, 3 and 7, and 3 and 5 and 7, which are divided by all numbers. So for example, let's say n 3 is the number of numbers which are divided by 3 between 1 and 500. They will be 500 by 3. That is, you can say 133. Okay, so that is 166. Sorry, this will be 166. Number of numbers divisible by 5 between 1 and 500 will be 500 by 5, that is 100. Number of numbers divisible by 7, that will be 500 by 7, that is 71. Okay, so then we have to find out the number of numbers divisible by both 3 and 5. Okay, number of numbers are divisible by 3 and 5, which means number should be divisible by 15. So 500 divided by 3 into 5, that will be 33. Number of numbers divisible by 5 and 7, that will be, number divisible should be 35, 5 into 7. So we will have such numbers that are 14 numbers. Okay, so number of numbers divisible by 3 and 7. So number should be divisible by 21. Okay, that is, we have 23 such numbers. And we have some numbers which are divisible by everything. That is 3, 5 and 7. So it should be divisible by 3 into 5, 15 into 7, that is 105. 500 by 105 will be 4, the integer value. So we know that the formulas, this is simple formula for n, a or b or c equals to number of a's plus number of b's plus number of c's minus number of a and b minus number of b and c minus number of c and a plus number of a and b and c. So you can put the values. This is number of A's, this is number of B's, this is number of C's, like this. All of these are number of A and B, B and C, C and A, A and B and C. So you can put the values. Number of A's are 166 plus number of B's are 100, number of C's are 71, number of A and B are 3, number of B and C are 14, number of C and A are 23 plus number of A and B and C are 4. Okay, so this will be, if you solve this, all this equation, this will be 271. So the correct answer for this question is C, that is 271. Question number 73, and this question says, consider the relation schema and we have four attributes A, B, C, D with following functional dependency set. A tends to C, B tends to D, A, E tends to D. Identify the highest normal form satisfied by the relation R. So there is a little mistake in this question, and in this question functional dependencies contains E, attribute E, and E is not in the relation. Relation is given R, A, B, C, D. So we can consider that we have E attribute also in the relation. So according to this, if we solve the question, we have functional dependencies A tends to CE, B tends to D and AE tends to D. So these are the functional dependencies we have. We have to find the appropriate normal form for this set of functional dependencies for this relation. So let's try with BCNF. What is the key? First step, finding, for if you want to solve any normalization question, first step is you should find the keys. So if I look at the keys are like AB. Okay, from AB can we derive all the attributes. A, from A I can derive A, C, A. And from B I can derive B and D. So all the attributes can be derived from AB, and we do not have any another key in this relation. ACEBD. So AB is the only key in this relation. So BCNF says all the left hand side should be a key, but this fails. BCNF fails because this is itself is not a key. So now 3NF says either left hand side should be a super key or right hand side should be a prime attribute. 3NF also fails. Neither the left hand side is a super key nor right hand side is a prime attribute. 2NF said there should not be any functional dependency. Okay, there should not be any partial functional dependency. Partial functional dependency, as we have already discussed, if we have a partial functional dependency like this, and let's say alpha is a prime attribute and beta is a non-key attribute, then this functional dependency will be known as partial dependency. Prime attributes means any part of candidate key. For example, A is a prime attribute, B is a prime attribute. So this functional dependency is partial dependency because A is the proper subset of candidate key and C is a non-key attribute. E is also a non-key attribute. In fact, these two, and this is not a partial dependency, this is also a partial dependency. This is not also in 2NF. So the relation is in 1NF. Question number 74 says, let G be a grammar in CFG and let W1, W2 be the strings which belongs to this language such that length of W1 is equal to length of W2. Then which of the following statements is true? So any derivation of W1 has exactly the same number of steps as any derivation of W2. Different derivations have different lengths. Some derivations of W1 may be shorter the derivation of W2. So which of the options are correct? What we can do is we can take a grammar and we can try this with the options. For example, I have a grammar that say A equals to A to the power M, B to the power N and C to the power N, and M, N are greater than equals to 0. This is my grammar. Okay. So let's say I have two strings, W1 equals to AABC. So I will take the same length strings. W1, W2 length should be same because this is given. Length of W1 should be equals to length of W2. Then we can look at the options. So let's say W2 equals to BBCC. And the grammar given is, okay, for this language, the grammar is this. S tends to AP. Okay, A tends to AA or null, P tends to BPC or null. Okay, this is the grammar for this language, and these two are the strings which can be derived from this grammar. Okay, let's try with W1. What is the length of W1? Length of W1 is 4. What is the length for W2? W2 length is 4. Any derivation of W1 has exactly the same number of steps as any derivation of W2. Let's try the derivation of this string. So the derivation of this string will be like this. I have to generate AABC. So first I will take AP, then A tends to AA because I want to generate AA. Then I want to generate because 2A, so I have to again take AAA. Let's put A equals to null. Okay, and we have P also. So if we put A equals to null, this will become AAP. Okay, then I can start generating B and C. So let's put in place of P, BPC. So this will become, after this will become AA. In place of P, I am putting BPC. BPC. Okay, now I have my string AABC, AABC, and P can I put null. So this will become AABC. So how many steps are there? First step, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth. Okay, so six steps are taking that in the derivation of AABC. So BBCC is also of the same length. So let's see how many steps will be taken in this. First is AP, then I have to generate BBCC. So I can simply generate a BBCC from this. I can put A tends to null simply. So this will become null into P. Now in place of P, what I can do is I can put BPC. BPC. again I have to generate double B because I have to generate BBCC. So I can again put BBPCC. So now I can put null in place of B. This will become BBCC. So now I have my string. So the steps are taken 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. In this length of 4, and this is also of length 4, in this string the steps are taken 6. In this string, second string, the length is length of step derivations are 5. So A is saying any derivation of W1 has exactly the same number of steps as any derivation of W2. This is false. Different derivations have different length. This is not always true. It is possible that we can have the, for example, I have any such string in which we can have same number of derivations. So different derivations have different length. This is not always true. Not always true. This may be true, but not always true. Some derivation of W1 may be shorter than the derivation of W2. This is true. In some case, W2 will be having the more number of steps. In some cases, W1 will be having the more number of steps. But due to this word, maybe. Okay, this option becomes true. So maybe means sometimes it may be true or it may be false. It is contingency. Okay, contingency. Question number 75 says, recursively enumerable languages are not closed under which operations? Okay, so as we have seen in first question of this paper, recursive enumerable languages, or you can say Turing recognizable languages. Okay, they are same, or semi-decidable languages, or partially decidable languages. All these languages are same. And these languages are closed under some operations. For example, recursively enumerable languages are closed under union operation. They are closed under intersection operation. They are closed under concatenation operation. They are closed under star operation. Okay, line star. They are closed. But there is a one operation, that is complement operation. They are not closed. Not closed under complement operations. Recursively enumerable languages are not closed under complement operations, and we have one more operation, that is set difference. Okay, set difference. If you have any language L which is recursively enumerable, and you have another language, that is, that may be any language. If you say L minus P, this is set difference. Recursive enumerable language minus any other language, it may be recursive enumerable, but not sure, maybe or may not be. This is open question. So they are not closed under complement operation and set difference operations. So this is saying recursive enumerable languages are not closed under set difference and complement. So B and C both are true. A and B both are true. Recursive enumerable languages are not closed under set difference and complement. Question number 76 says, the optimization phase in a compiler generally reduces the space of the code. B optimizes the code to reduce execution time. So obviously in code optimization phase of the compiler, what we do is we actually optimize the intermediate code, in which we do multiple, we use the many techniques for optimization. For example, loop optimization techniques, constant folding, okay, loop unrolling, loop jamming, all these techniques are used in optimization phase to reduce the space of the code. For example, we can remove the redundant instructions from the code to reduce the space of the code. Okay, space of the code can be reduced in the optimization phase by simply removing some code. Okay, this is true. Optimizes the code to reduce the execution time. This is also true, because if we can optimize the loops, okay, loop covers the most of the part of the most of the time loops are executing of the program. Okay, so loop is a major part of the program. So what we try to optimize the loops. For that purpose, we use many techniques. Okay, so we can reduce the code, the optimize the code to such that it runs in some less time. So both A and B are true. C is the right answer. Question number 77 says, what is the meaning of regular expression sigma star 001 sigma star? Okay, so any string of 01, then followed by 001, then any string of 01. So A is saying any string containing 1 as substring. This is false, because the minimum length is 001. Okay, 001 is mandatory. So this will be in all the strings. Whatever string you take from this language, this will be in all the strings. For example, the strings which are generated by this language will be like this. First string will be 001 of length 3. Then second string can be, we can take 0 from here, like 001. And then we can take 1 from here, or we can take 0 from here. For example, we can take 0010, taking null from here and 0 from here. 001 is mandatory in all these strings. And after 001 or before 001 or after and before, you can add anything. So 001 is mandatory. Any string containing 01 as substring, this is also false. Any string containing 011 as substring, this is false, because 001 should be substring. All strings containing 001 as substring, this is true. Okay, this is the simple definition of substring. Okay, question number 78. This is a very good question from the computer architecture. A two-word instruction is stored in a location A. Okay, the operand part of the instruction holds B. So operand part is B. If the addressing mode is relative, this is important, addressing mode is relative, the operand is available in which location? Okay, so this is saying we have a memory in which we have a two-word instruction. Two-word means one instruction is taking two words. For example, if instruction starts from A, okay, a two-word instruction is stored in the location A. It starts from the A. So this word taken by the instruction, okay, and this word, that is A plus 1, is also taken by instruction I1. These two words are occupied by this instruction, location A and A plus 1. So we know that program counter points to the next location, that is A plus 2. So program counter is pointing to this location now, because we know that program counter points to the next instruction in the list. So first instruction is here, next one will be from 1, A plus 2 and A plus 3, like this. So what is PC relative mode? What is relative mode? The relative mode is like this, load X PC. This is called PC relative mode, in which effective address is calculated like this, PC plus X. Okay, this is the address calculated. This will be the effective address. Okay, and we know that in this given question, the operand part of instruction holds B. Operand part is this. So now this instruction becomes like this, load B PC. So this, the effective address, this is saying the operand is available in the location. Okay, operand is available in what location? This is simply asking the effective address. Effective address is nothing but the location of the operand. So in this case, effective address will be like this. If you want to understand effective address, what is effective address? If you look at the indirect mode, indirect addressing mode, in this case, instructions are given like this, load at the rate 3000. This simply means that you, to find the effective address, you have to make two memory accesses. Okay, this is saying you have a location 3000 on which 4000 is stored, and 4000 on the location 4000 we have operand, that is 40. So you have to make two memory accesses to access the operand. First you have to access 3000, then within 3000 you will get the effective address. On the, after reaching the effective address, you can find the operand. So this is the effective address, address of the operand. So in this case, the address of the operand will be like this. The value of PC is A plus 2. Okay, if you take PC plus X, the value of PC is A plus 2 plus B, this one. So this will be the effective address, that is A plus B plus 2. Okay, this will be the effective address from the PC relative mode. Question number 79 says, which of the following are undecidable? Okay, undecidable. So if you look at the, this is asking about CFGs. Okay, if you look at the decidability in the CFGs. Okay, what are the things we can decide in the CFGs? Okay, what are the things are decidable in the CFGs? For example, first is membership problem. Membership problem means, can we find that a string, for example, we have a string W, does W belongs to this CFG or not? Okay, this question, can you answer this question in yes or no? If you can answer this question in yes or no, if you can find any algorithm, then this is decidable. For this purpose, we have CYK algorithm in CFGs, which runs in order of n cube. So we have a polynomial time algorithm to find this. So this is decidable in the CFGs. Then second problem is finiteness. Okay. Finiteness means if CFG is finite, can you say that this is finite? This is also decidable. We can find the finiteness of a language of the CFG. Then third is emptiness. Emptiness means we are asking, is the language is phi? Can you answer this question? Is language is phi, which means this is the problem of emptiness. And emptiness problem in the CFGs are decidable. This is decidable. Then fourth problem is equivalence problem. Okay, is this decidable? Equivalence means, can you say that L1 is equals to L2? Can you find out this? Okay, we do not have any algorithm for this. That's why this is undecidable in the CFG. Equivalence problem in case of CFGs is undecidable. Then we have very obvious problem, ambiguity. And we know that we do not have any algorithm which can tell us whether the language is ambiguous or not. This is also undecidable. Okay, this is also undecidable in CFGs. Then we have a problem, does L accept everything? Okay, is this language accept everything? This is also undecidable. Then is the intersection of two languages, phi, are they mutually exclusive? This is also undecidable. Okay. So like this, we have these all the questions, and in CFGs we can answer only three questions: membership, finiteness and emptiness. All other things, all other problems are undecidable in the CFGs. So P1 is saying the language generated by some CFG contains any word of length less than some given number n. So this is decidable. Okay, this is decidable. This is membership problem simply. Let L1 be CFL and L2 be regular to determine whether L1 and L2 have common elements. Okay, can we find this? Can we have common elements? So we cannot find out this. P3 is saying any given CFG is ambiguous or not. This is obviously undecidable language. Okay, P4 is saying for any given CFG G to determine whether epsilon belongs to this language. Okay, membership problem is okay, decidable. So P4 is decidable. P2 and P3 are undecidable in the CFGs. So option C is answer, because the question is asking about undecidability in this. Question number 80 says, a system has three processes sharing four resources. Okay, so we have three processes, P1, P2, P3 and four resources. If each process needs maximum of 2 units, so maximum requirement of each process is 2. So what if we can give n-1 resources to m-1 processes and we have one more left, then we can say the system is not in deadlock. So we require minimum 4 resources to ensure that there will not be a deadlock. Okay, for example, we have number of resources should be greater than equals to m-1 into n+1. Okay, which means after giving n resources, after giving m-1, m is maximum requirement, after giving m-1 resources to n processes, to all processes, we should have one more resource. Okay, this is true. We can give one resources to 2 processes and all maximum requirements to 1 process. Okay, so P3 starts executing. Okay, even if this will make a progress, because P3 can start the execution, because P3 requires maximum 2 resources and 2 resources are given. This will execute and release the resources so that all process can start executions. So if we want to ensure that deadlock never occurs, number of resources should be minimum 4. Okay, and in this question it is given that sharing 4 resources. 4 resources are already there. We have R equals to 4 which are required. So there is no chance of deadlock. Can never occur. Deadlock can never occur is the right answer for this question.